growing up on Kāpiti Island, I could look up at the hills and know that they were there when my tūpuna were here six generations ago. There's a path that we walk down to the beach. Every time I walk down that, I imagine my tūpuna running down that same track in bare feet to go and do their mahi, to go and collect kai. And that's pretty special, knowing that you are literally walking in the footsteps of your tūpuna.
Beyond the sandy shores of the Kāpiti coast lies the almost divine presence of Te Waiwai Kāpiti o Tararawa ko Rangitāne, known more commonly as Kāpiti Island.
I've been looking at Kāpiti from afar for I don't know how many years. You drive past it whenever you're coming up the coast there from Wellies going up north, and it's always seemed like something that's removed from us, like this mystical thing out in the mist out there.
Kāpiti Island is 10 k's long and around 2 k's wide, and located at the northern entrance of Te Moana o Raukawa. Awaiting you on the other side of the 20-minute boat ride from Paraparaumu is a whole new world.
Far out, look at these rocks. Wow, you don't see this every day.
What's that, rocks?
Oh man, these types of rocks or this type of shore.
The island is the permanent home to thousands of birds and not many people. But there are kaitiaki here, a whānau who take their role as guardians seriously.
So watercress doesn't just keep on growing. You've got to manage how you harvest it, basically. You notice I'm leaving quite a bit. I'm not taking it all. Just take enough for a feed once in a while. Indigenous people understand indigenous connections with their land. And we're no different from Canadian Indigenous people, Australian Indigenous people. We all understand what our connection is to the land through our ancestors and through our atua, through the gods of the forest and the land and the sea.
I think of Kāpiti Island as one of those mystical places. It's an untouched terrain. It's like Jurassic Park up in there. You've been coming back and forth here since you were a child, since you were young?
Yeah, I've been coming here for 70 years. For us, you definitely get a sense of belonging here, and you know that ukaipō feeling comes through being here. So this is where we get our strength from, actually. If we've got any strength, this is where it comes from, our attachment to this place. I came here first in 1955. Yeah, so I was only, 5 years old. My mum came with a Māori women's welfare group. Boatload of Māori women.
What can you tell me about this particular bay? Why was this one picked to be the one that you have the batches on?
So this is Wairua Bay. Wairua really is the genesis of the iwi settlement in this part of the country. 1824 was the year of the big battle that took place right here in this bay that settled Ngāti Tor's mana over the lower part of the North Island. When it came up to the 1890s, when most of the whānau were moving off the island, my koro's whānau was left here as ahikā. So there's always been some of our whānau here in this particular place. So, 1897, the Crown acquired this place through legislation, and that required all the owners to sell to the Crown. We're still here because Granny, Utota Parata, refused to budge. Her process was not to reply to letters. She just never replied to letters. Kuia died at 53 or 58, and the Crown did acquire all of the remaining land except 30 acres. And that was a concession to the family. You fellas can have 30 acres, you know, be happy with 30 acres.
So are these the only
The only ones here.
That you know of?
There's another Ulu part at the other end of the island, yeah. And we know a lot of people were taken up from here and moved down to the caves at the other end. Around about the 1970s, my wife and I started coming back here for weekends. There was an old whare still here, and we'd come back and spend weekends there. It was rat-infested. There were possums in the water supply. It was pretty rough. Our kaitiaki role wasn't handed to us. And it wasn't until things started to develop around us it became clearer the significance of what was happening. We developed a good working relationship with the Department of Conservation. We took part in the eradication programs that took place here, possums and rats. The more we did, the longer we stayed, the better the relationships got with those partners. What's really exciting is our iwi, who have an affiliation in the whakapapa of the Kāpiti Island, are taking a much more active interest in kaitiaki tanga.
Do you have any pakiwaitara about this place?
There's the stories of the swim by one of our kuia from that place down there, that's Kahira o Tarangi, named after that kuia. She swam from there over to Te Urihipā on the mainland. It's quite a difficult story to put logic around, but she did it. Mm. And she did it with a baby strapped to her. So it's quite a story of a strong, Ngāti Toa woman who did.
As a nature reserve, visitor numbers to Kāpiti are pretty strict. But there are a couple of accommodation options for visitors wanting the overnight experience.
This is my abode for the week. I think they call it glamping. Pretty flash, but then it's being able to lie there and look straight out. It feels like we're somewhere where not many people have ever been, so feeling pretty lucky.
Most of the whānau don't live on Kāpiti Island permanently, but they come and go week to week.
I always say to people that the reason that I got involved with Barrett was because of the island. He doesn't like me saying that. But I mean, the island was a part of him. I knew that the island went with him, and he went with the island.
When you live in the middle of a bird sanctuary, you actually have to have doors that the ground-dwelling birds can't get in. The workers can't get in here, but unfortunately the kākā can.
It was just a very natural thing to be doing, to come over here, yeah. We started building a batch over here.
When would this be, like 70s?
Yeah.
In the 70s?
Yeah. We got an old batch helicoptered over from the mainland because the uncle was over here behind the puhurakawa trees, so we thought we'd go up this, give him some privacy. And Uncle Mike came over one day and said, you know, what the hell are you guys doing? Why do you want to come over here and use our shelter? So then we had to pick up all these walls that we'd cut in pieces from this batch over there and physically walk them over to here. We used to come here every chance we could. And then before our firstborn went to school, we decided to come over here and just live for a while. I mean, we had no money, and there was no running water. There was a long drop of
wharepaku,
no power, white spirit lanterns. You know, it was fabulous and basic. John used to fish out of this little dinghy that he had to tie himself into, and he was always quite relieved when he came back again.
Can you do this bit?
So this bit on the top is going to go over that one and under the next one.
What drew you to Daringa?
Probably a conscious drawing that said to me that I wanted our kids to know how to weave before their grandmother was too old to teach them. It was Piki, John's mum at that stage. She was probably the only weaver in Ōtaki at that particular time. And it took me a while. It didn't just come naturally, but yeah, I just got right into it.
How many moko have you guys got?
Six. It starts off for the kids as being a place to come to, but they need to also know the importance of it and the role that it's played in our local history. It's not just a playground. They need to know they are kaitiaki of the place. And I mean, the fact that if John's grandmother hadn't said, no, Crown, you can't have this bit, we wouldn't be here. Yeah. So there's that gratitude that always underlies everything.
Do you feel like time kind of disappears when you come out here?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, what day is it today? I don't know.
With no predators on Kāpiti, the natural pre-human ecosystem is recovering. And it's impressive.
The first thing that strikes you is the birds, the amount of birds, and how loud it is. Just seeing so many birds I've never seen up close before, and just sounds I'd never heard before. Some sounding like violins, some sounding like car alarms. Nature is king over here.
Kāpiti Island is the summit of a submerged mountain range created 200 million years ago by earthquakes. And it kind of makes sense. It feels like it's part of an ancient world.
I need everyone to have a little bit of imagination. I'm going to try and get you back in time before humans were here. We had Jurassic-type park birds. We had 11 species of moa, ranging from 1 metre to nearly 4 metres. We had the poor kite, the biggest eagle in the world, that would pick up the moa and take it away. We've even heard myths of the poor kite picking up children and taking them away. It was a very big bird. Obviously, the moana around us, the sea, birds on land, it was a pretty good place to be.
Well, I suppose a good place to start is, how did you come to be sitting looking at this beautiful view?
My family have been here since 1820 from the migration from Kāwhia with Ngāti Tua Rangatira. We were involved with whaling when the whalers came here in the mid-1820s. So you're looking at the merging of pretty much two cultures way back then. A lawless type of society, I suppose, back in those days. It would have been a really interesting time to be a fly on the wall, I suppose. Been through the whaling, then it went to farming. Farming sort of lasted for most people for about 50 years on Kāpiti. In 1897, the government decided that Kāpiti Island looks like the ideal place to put a reserve. So they've gone about purchasing the land off the owners, Māori owners and the European owners. They get most of it, they didn't get it all. They didn't get this 514-acre block down here. So we've got away from farming. We now farm humans, as in tourists. humans eat way less grass than sheep and cattle. So it's a lot better for the land, I suppose. So my cousin developed an ecotourism lodge. So I've been working for my cousin for the last 5 years. There you go. Watch out for the kākās. We've already lost one block of blue vein.
Okay.
Doesn't take them long. They hone in very quickly.
Especially when they're dealing with old people.
Most people, when they go on that boat, they don't want to leave. Yeah. They've found this little part of New Zealand here, Aotearoa. That's a pretty cool place, and they pretty much chill out. And we just sort of conduct that along the way, if you like. So it seems to work quite well.
Comes in every morning, every afternoon, or night time. Give them a wee date.
Do you ever feel like when you're sitting here looking back that it's like us against them, like on this like Garden of Eden type thing?
Yeah, well, I try not to go back to the mainland too often. Some people are calling me a bit of a hermit now because they haven't seen me on the mainland for such a long time. I have some of my mates who are, when are you coming back? But I say to them, well, if you want to come and see me, you come over here, come and see me.
I'm very envious of you. You're very lucky, man. What a beautiful spot.
The whānau here feel a deep connection to this motu, and they carry that with them whether on or off the island.
It's up to us to point out your tūpuna walking beside you so you know you're never alone. That's how I feel now, and I know that's not always been true. A It's up to us to help you more than just hear the words of those tūpuna in the Waiata they left us, to feel their tangi and aroha in your bones. Your bones will remember. They remember your place here. They remember your importance. I want your mind to know that too. Know that you carry our past and future with you. Understand you are a part of something bigger. I mean, Kāpiti for me has always been pretty multi-layered, right? Like there is the whenua itself, the ngātua Māori, so like the connection that it has to our whakapapa that way. Then there is the history of my tūpuna, and then there's just the personal me knowing that, you know, whatever is going on in my life, I can always go back to that island. Growing up, we lost my two sisters who drowned out off Kāpiti Island. Having watched mum and dad be able to go on with their own lives, carry on as a whānau, now that I've got kids, I can kind of start to even mildly comprehend what that would have been like. One of the most defining moments of my life was when I was 22. I had a car crash driving from Ōtaki to Palmerston. It was a head-on crash. I broke my femur, crushed my feet, punctured my lung, had pretty serious head trauma, and was in a wheelchair in a hospital bed for the next 4 months. But then at the end of about a week, the police arrived and stood at the door of my room and told me that the woman in the car that I'd hit had passed away and that they were charging me with taking her life. Because I was also dealing with my physical injuries, it took quite a while for it to sink in. My dad actually said to me in the hospital bed, he said, don't let this be something that takes your life as well. And with everything that he's been through, that was a really powerful and important reminder and words that I've been lived by, I think. That's really affected my thinking from then on. If I'm alive, then I need to be making sure that I'm enjoying that life and I'm making the most of it. Otherwise, I might as well be dead. Probably Huhana being born. Like, I think that was when I kind of realised there's real benefit and value in me articulating this situation for her and telling her how I dealt with that mamai, because she'll have her own to deal with, right? I hope that she'll be able to look back and know that, okay, cool, my nana and granddad dealt with this, and my dad dealt with that, I can deal with this. I meditate every morning to get my mind right. Through that meditation, I go out under the whenua and under the sea and pop back up on the island, which is obviously not as good as being there and soaking in the actual sound of the manu and the trees, but, you know, it's better than not being there at all.
Maybe it's the dawn chorus of the manu or the thick blanket of fog I've woken up to, but Kāpiti Island feels like a mystical place, almost otherworldly.
I feel super alone right now, just because it's so misty over there, can't see the mainland. I was getting a kind of heebie-jeebie vibes, I don't know what that means. Oh, here we go. Okupe Lagoon. So since we got here, I've been wanting to see that lagoon. There are different accounts of the story that after the pukanga in 1820, this is where they put all of their tūpapaku. It's a super tapu place.
The people here feel that deep connection to their history. It's an important part of their identity.
I'm not sure what appealed to me most, being more connected to our whakapapa or being more connected to the taiao. I think for a lot of us, that's what draws us in. Just how close to the surface all that stuff is, there's a potency. And I don't know if it's an island thing or just Kāpiti in particular, but it's just this focal point of all of these different kaupapa that are important to us all in different ways, but it's all just brought together here so tightly and so close to the surface. There's always some weka drama going on.
Yeah.
Standard weka drama.
I don't even know if I've ever seen a weka. I suppose a good place to start would be how you fit into this puzzle of Kāpiti.
Yeah, so Kāpiti's always been a bit of a refuge for us. Growing up, that was our relationship with the place, a bit of an escape from the mainland. Today, we've got flushing wharepaku and hot showers and things, so it's a bit different, I suppose. But over the last 10 years, yeah, I've had the opportunity to be out here a bit more, spending about half of my time, I suppose, here and half on the mainland.
Kia ora mai tātou. Welcome to Te Waiwai Kāpiti a Tararau o Korangi Tāne, which is the actual name of this island. Kāpiti's just a little snippet of that full name. Being a nature reserve just means that this is the most tightly protected legally that conservation land can be. A full-blown nature reserve is a pretty significant thing. It's also one of the oldest examples of a conservation project in the world, and this place has been going since 1897 in this phase of restoration.
Today we're really in a space of coming to better understand our obligations today in terms of kaitiakitanga around Te Taiao. There's been a lot of work done here over the last 120 years to try and undo some of the damage we did to this place. We had possums here when I was born, 22,000 possums removed kind of when I came along. First place in the world to get rid of rats when I was kind of 10 years old. So at these kind of points, the big changes in how the ngāhere is revitalised, how the manu have flooded back into it. This is my campsite here, just next to the repo. It's not the corner that you'd pick if you wanted a quiet, peaceful, soundless sleep, but I quite enjoy being surrounded by all these noises. The most noise, there's a nice little overlap between when the nighttime manu and the daytime manu overlap. So you get the dawn chorus at kind of 4:30 to 5:30, and at that same sort of time you've got ruru going to sleep, you've got kiwi making a lot of noise as they head to sleep, you've got lots of weka making noise. You get a lot of that, yeah, overlap. All of the manu on the block are up doing something.
What did you want to pass down to your own children for them to take on and carry on and maybe pass on to their children?
We need to be pretty active in looking after what has been passed on to us for us to then pass on to the next generation. You know, my mokopuna will know what a tieke sounds like, where we don't know what a huia sounds like because of those failings of the last 200 years. Yeah. Ultimately, I think preventing further extinction and preventing further loss of mātauranga Māori are kind of the responsibilities of today.
Since Utauta Parata first denied the Crown the sale of iwi land, the story of Kāpiti has been a masterclass in Māori self-determination. But the job isn't over yet. The whānau here want to take even more of a lead heading into the future.
He wāhi tūpuna katoa tēnei. Kuia pē te taonga nui o tēnei wāhi. Ko te wāhi takahi ai o mātou tūpuna, tai atu ki ngā tūpuna e nehe. Ke hau nei nau a waku wawata mō tēnei mautere mō Kāpiti. Te āhei tonu o mātou uri, o mātou tamariki, mokopuna. Te hikoi mai ki konei. Te whakatūtuki hoki e ngā mahi a te papa atawhai. Mea ke au nei, mā o mātou tamariki kē te rāmai. Waiho mā rātou, hei mahi mā rātou pia. Hei mea whakarau ora anō i te oranga o te ngāhere o te waonui o tāni konei. Waku wawata, ke hanga e tētahi. He marae anō ki roto nei, ki konei. Hei tūranga wawai pē mō mātu uri whakaheke. Kia tū hono hono anō ki tēnei wāhi. Ko tukā rō mātou e, ea ua māhue mai i tēnei kāinga. Engari, me te kimi i tētahi huarahi kia tāe ai tātou ki te e hoki mai ki te mautere, ki ngā mautere. I rongo te moe, ono mātou tūpuna kia, he tino wāhi enei kia o mātou tūpuna. Hei wāhi a i tia kia hei manaaki o mātou uri.
As my time on Kāpiti and my travels around the outer islands of Aotearoa comes to an end, I'm soaking up the last of this experience.
I feel like the vibe that this place gives me is something that I've only got in a few other places. But it's a feeling of, like, timelessness.
People are awesome. Everyone I've got to talk to and hang out with over the last couple of days. And very tūturu to this island. It's a big part of who they are, and they want to conserve it for the next generation.
It's the story I've found on all the islands I've visited during this time. They are the kaitiaki, the ahikā and the holders of special knowledge. The people in these places are preserving a way of life that's been lost in many other places on Earth. They are holding on tight to the things they know are important above all else, and perhaps hoping the rest of us realise it too, before it's too late.